wanted to share with you some, well, I need to apologize first. There are a lot of people in this room have seen parts of this presentation. I gave this at the Mississippi Association of Grantmakers. We were talking about food systems development. So, but also I think it may have overlapped with what you just heard as well. So, sorry, but it's okay. This is information we need to think about when we think about systems development. I just drove in from Starkville, so I'm didn't get to hear all of the earlier presentation, but it sounds like it was similar. David actually put this together, and I'm really happy to be working with David, thinking about food systems development in the state. You'll learn about what they're doing with Up and Farmed Food Hub and the incredible work and importance of this work. My background is food systems development in North Carolina. I moved back to Mississippi about a year ago, but for the last 10 to 15 years, I've been working in food systems development in southeastern North Carolina. Created a food system in 11 counties in the southeastern part of the state. Worked closely with our state partners to strengthen and buttress this work that many people are doing in North Carolina, and very similarly to the efforts that you'll hear about this afternoon. I kind of came with the idea of, okay, how can we create a system? And that's what I want to think about today. But just to give us context for what we're thinking about, this is really a relocalization of a food system, right? Bringing it back to local. With the changes that we've seen in the way in which food is manufactured and produced since World War II, we've got a significant shift in actually just a banner in the works, right, of how food is produced and distributed to us. So we see more commodity production, more focus on bringing products in rather than developing from within, and this increase in large-scale agriculture. So when we're thinking about food systems, we're thinking about small-scale, typically looking to work with limited resource and socially disadvantaged growers who've been left out of this model. And then all of these pieces to the food system that are important to think about. During the same time, we have a real significant shift in farm policy, and so this has helped make this system sort of this banner in the works of a system we used to have, sort of just turned it all around with a farm policy that's really focused on buttressing commodity production. And so with that, we've seen the significant decline in this commodity price of corn and soybean that gives us these types of products that give us a long shelf life, that make things cheap and available. But at the same time, you have none of these subsidies or supports going to fruits and vegetables, and so we actually see a significant increase in those. So this is part of this system, the change in production, but as well as the farm policy that's really supported this type of new production, new system of food. So what we have then are these cheap products that have long shelf life, and you know, we also have consumers who are different, who need things that have a long shelf life. We don't cook, as we learned in the last session. We don't think about food in the same way that maybe, at least for my family, I can point to one generation back where we grew. Everyone had a plot, had some land, had something that, you know, some kitchen garden, if nothing else, and we're cooking. And so we have a different shift. We have change in gender roles within the household. Many things it's complex, right? It's not one or two things. But a farm policy that supports this has added to this, what is now a health crisis, right? A health epidemic around obesity. And so I think this was discussed in the last session. It looks like I caught the tail end of it. But here we are, because of the way we produce food and the type of food that we produce and that's cheap, we are heavier than we were in the 1960s. The CDC calls obesity a health epidemic, and indeed, Mississippi is one of the states leading that epidemic. So I'll just I show them slides. See, the next slides are a set of CDC slides, Center for Disease Control, that show the increase in obesity. How many of you have seen this sort of, okay, half the room, okay. Let me go through it for you, for those who haven't. But what you're seeing is it darkens, you're seeing the increase in obesity and these trends, 88, and we'll just move through. You can watch the southern states get darker. 91, we get a new category, and that category, if you can't see it, is 15 to 19% of the adult population. So we get a new category. Mississippi helps lead the way, 20%. A new category in 2001, which is, I believe it's over 30%. And a new category in 2005, I believe that's over 35%. So, here we are with the crisis, right? And if we look at the work I was doing in North Carolina, we were really focused on economic development. That's really how we got started. We were looking at small-scale farmers, wanted to understand how we could help support their farm businesses so that they could reach and the demand that we were creating through institutional buying and through consumer awareness of the importance of buy local. So we were really thinking about economic development. But increasingly, we started to, because our work is with poverty alleviation, we wanted to target people who did not have access to healthy, affordable food. And so these issues of obesity and health disparities become more and more prevalent when you're thinking about the food system and thinking about who has access to food and these issues of food insecurity. And so if we think about a food system and really creating a system, we have to have all of these pieces in place. We need to think about the production and supporting farmers and doing that work, the supply, the distribution, which we'll hear about shortly, the access, who has access to this healthy, affordable food, and increasing demand, the many labor issues and many other issues in a system, in really creating a system. So in doing this, we need to think about what local means, and we've got many different conceptualizations of that. But by and large, it's about place. It's about the people who are growing your food, that connectedness with the folks in the community. It's about a very short supply chain, so it's not necessarily California to your plate or Mexico to your plate. It's your farmer to your plate. Very short supply chain. And for me, these issues of social embeddedness are really, as a rural sociologist, these are the things that I get passionate about and really care about. So how those social connections, that those ideas of trust and connectedness and reciprocity that come from knowing where your food comes from and ensuring that everyone has access to that food and that healthy, affordable food. It's complex, and that's, I guess, the thing to think about constantly. How do we do this? How do we do this work? I mean, it's hard. It doesn't happen fast. But we can build and have learning communities where we can build on examples of this conference. How can we build and learn on what people are doing in other parts of the country, what people are doing in Mississippi? How can we come together and build a food system for the whole state? So these are some of the things that we're working on. I'm working at Mississippi State to try to create an umbrella organization and sort of an infrastructure so that we can learn from everything that's coming into the state and what's happening in the state. Lots of pots of money come in, but when the money goes away, often the projects go away. And this is not new. This is what happens in community organizing and work that is a lot of volunteer labor, a lot of folks coming together to make change. So, how can we organize this? How can we have some sort of central mechanism where we can document and learn and build on the initiatives that are happening in Mississippi? As I go around the state, I see a lot of things happening. We also have a lot of need, and for people from Mississippi in the room, that's not a surprise to you. It's the state with the highest food insecurity. So the United States has about 14% of its population considered food insecure. And this is, food insecurity is a measure of hunger in essence, right? It's really capturing that need of food. And in many respects, it's capturing access, but it's mostly just capturing hunger. If you look at this map, and I'm sorry you can't really see it, it's a map that's capturing the poverty in the state. So Mississippi has significant persistent poverty. That's poverty rates over 20% over 30 years. For most of these counties, it's over 40 or 50 years. This is deep embedded poverty. The darker the green, the greater the poverty, but also the numbers, which unfortunately you can't see, but I'm happy to send this slide to you, are the food insecurity rates, and those are very high. So if you sort of match this with obesity, you're gonna see that a nice coupling of data, right? These are statistically significant relationships of poor, poverty, hunger, obesity, this paradox that we see in the United States of malnourishment now being equated to obesity. And I think you probably had that in your last session as well. So what do we do? How do we move ahead? Today we're gonna learn what Up and Farms Food is doing, probably the leaders in the state on innovative ways to create systems and communities and in a fully integrated sense of how to not just processing and distribution, but addressing these needs of access and hunger. But it's a manageable state. Having worked in North Carolina, which seems much bigger, 100 counties and 7 to 8 hours from one end to the other, this is a state that has lots of things happening, and this is very encouraging and exciting to me because we can see these points of promise of things that are happening. We need to build on those and see the way we can learn from one another to uplift this and create a full system for the state of Mississippi. So I think I will turn it over to David now, and I can't help him get to his presentation because I don't have those skills. But that's my contact information. We're going to do Q&A shortly, and I'll welcome talking to you about this and thinking about this together as we build a food system in Mississippi.
Thank you, Leslie. I look forward to bringing Leslie back up here in a minute and doing Q&A together so we can really dive in here. I'm gonna kind of go on a limb and do something a little different. I have a presentation I normally do about food hubs, but I've been thinking about food systems and where we are with that. And I just like to let you guys be guinea pigs, if you don't mind. Is everybody okay with being guinea pig in this, and let's have a real discussion about food systems and kind of where we are, what it means, and where we might be able to go. I like that, so I'm gonna just kind of fumble around for a minute, so work with me, and feel free to raise your hand and let's interact. So when you talk about food systems, it's kind of like looking at the universe, and the universe is a really big thing. And how do you describe the universe? Well, you can come up with, you can measure it, you can describe it, have this, but what do you really know about everything that's within the universe just by looking at that? Well, you really need to start drilling down and you start looking at galaxies and then solar systems within that and then planets. Oh, planets, okay. Solar systems, planets. That's something that's a little bit more tangible. We can comprehend that a little bit better now. And then within planets, there are all these creatures running around. Now, so that's kind of like when we talk about a food system, you might look at that as like a universe. But it's really made up of many, many interlocking systems within it. There's overlap. There's not a single food system. There's not one thing that defines that. It's just an aggregation of many, many systems that are working together, sometimes working against each other, alongside each other. Some never touch each other, but there's a lot of overlap. So at its most basic level, what is necessary for a food system? What's that?
Food.
Great. So food. So that means food just appears?
Produce food.
You have to produce it. Somebody's growing food. So you grow food, let's say here. So what happens with it when you grow it? And it's just most basic level. What's the most basic food system you can imagine?
You grow it, you eat it.
You grow it, you eat it. But do you really just grow it and you eat it? How do you do that? What's involved in growing it and eating it? Just still in its, pretty rudimentary levels.
prepare the soil, plant the seeds, go get the initial animals.
Are you doing animals or are you doing vegetables?
Well,
are you doing fruits? Are you doing all these things? So you got to think about that, what time of the year you're going to be planting things and growing. So you got to do some planning, some strategy within that. You're going to pull some stuff out of the ground. You just kind of dive into it. You just eat it like right after you pull it out of the ground or right after you kill it. How do you kill it? What do you do to the from there? What do you do when you pull the stuff out of the ground and you've got an animal and you decide you want to eat it? What do you do? Cook it. There you go. You cook it. What do you need to cook it?
Heat source.
You need pots and pans. You probably need a stove or an oven, you know, and you might want to refrigerate some of that as well. So, you know, and you're going to need utensils. You're going to need plates. So there are things that you need that are sort of part of a food system, but you don't always think about that as a food system. But what I'm trying to get at here is that there are other things that come often from outside the community that you might need in order to just help you do some of your most basic things. Not always, but oftentimes if you want to do them quicker or faster, you do. So let's say we've got a grower over here. So this is, you're growing, all right? This table is growing, and this table over here is buying, all right? So now we have a more extended food system. So you are buying food from them to sell to them, right? Okay, they're your only growers or do you have more growers?
Usually more,
because what are they growing for you? These guys, what are y'all growing?
We're growing broccoli and fall vegetables right now and kale.
Yeah.
Broccoli, kale, some sweet potatoes, you're going that. But you also serve fish at your restaurant, don't you? Are y'all bringing in the trout?
The thing where you grow the vegetables and the fish feed on the, and then they
food. Okay, what about the sushi? Is that coming from here too? Is that coming from the pond, you know, in the cows? And what about the orange juice? And you guys got some great papaya that you serve there. Is that, so the point is you're probably gonna have numerous people that are supplying you. And are you the only place? Is this the only table here?
No.
Okay. Well, who are you selling to? You're selling to this table over here. And who are you guys selling to, since you're buying food too? You're selling to them too, right? And hopefully to them and them and them. So you're trying to sell to more people too. And where are you getting your food from? Last place. Are you getting it from them? How are you determining who you're going to sell your food to?
We make a marketing move to them and ask them to buy our food and tell them why it's a good thing to buy. We're going to approach our customers. And
they say yes and we'll give you 5 cents for it.
Well, if 5 cents is appropriate, then that's what we'll take. If it's not, we'll
give you 5 cents for an entire truck.
No.
And they'll give you $5,000 for an entire truck. Well, who are you going to sell to?
I'm going to give it to the 5,000.
Okay. So suddenly, and you say, okay, well, maybe after we're running our economics on this and we've gone through our trust fund that we can't afford to spend $5,000 on the next truck, so what are we going to do?
Negotiate
or find something else. And you guys think over there, maybe that 5 cents we offered last time didn't really work. So you're gonna have to maybe offer a little more or find someone else, right? Maybe that table over there will sell it for 5 cents, you know? So, okay, so suddenly this is starting to become kind of complex, all right? And what if you guys make something that really nobody else makes? Like, you guys something kind of unique, right? And you know, I just have this table here, but there's another table over there on the other side of the Ag Museum, way over there. How are you going to get to them?
Well, we'll determine if it's what it costs to transport it.
Let's consider this is a universe, and that's the other side of your.
Yeah.
Okay. So there's going to, you might run it over there. You might drive it over there, but it might be 1,000 miles. And if you're here in the United States, food is traveling about 1,500 miles, 2,000 miles to get to where you are. So more likely than not, somebody else is gonna be doing that. So you might bring your product to them. That table over there in the back, right there, hey. So y'all are gonna bring in their product, right? And then you're gonna drive it over there. But how much do you need on your truck? Are you going to drive a product with just this little amount on your truck? Are you going to make money or lose money if you're taking your truck to get it to that table on the other side of the universe? And you got, y'all with me? Y'all understand? So you're going to want a full truck, right? So you're going to want to talk to this table, that table, the other table, or they're going to need to throw a whole lot of stuff for you to take it over there. And you might have a couple of trips along the way. And then you get there and you realize, oh, we made it all the way there. Now we got an empty truck. And now we got to pay the gas mileage to get all the way back. All right? And so we're just barely going to lose money. So what do we need to do? What do we need? Everything is paid for except the gas on the way back. So we need to figure out something that we can pick up there and bring that truck back so we can get it here and sell this so we can make some money on this side. All right. So is that starting to make a little more sense? We can do it very easy. You can make some stuff, but you still got to have a system. Who's going to grow what? Somebody's growing, somebody's planting stuff, somebody's picking it, somebody's cooking it, you know, and they're storing it and they're doing that. And then, but you still got to have plates, and you still got to have some other things. You still got to pay your electric bills. So you still got to have other economy coming in to be able to put money in to pay for those things that are inputs into your system, you know, or else you have a totally self-contained community, which is, it's hard to do. Maybe it's possible, but it's hard to do. But we have examples of some communities like that that can be more self-sustaining, that can grow food within that community to try to take care of each other, to try to feed each other, you know, because you're building a sense of community, or you're building you're trying to, you know, solve real hunger, you know? Or you can sell product and try to make money off of it, because people need to eat in other areas that may not have access to land to grow that food. And then you're creating wealth that you use to spend on other things. You know, so there's no good or bad or right or wrong, perfect in there. Well, I'll take that back. There are some bads. There are some bads in here. But there's not one system that is going to define everything. It's just not. These are many interlocking systems, some small, some large, that work together. Is that a yawn, or is that, oh, I was so hoping that was a question, but no, it's not. It's not. False alarm. So I was just kind of doing a little brainstorming right before here, and I put together a slide, and I already know this is wrong. It's a bad slide, and, you know, but I put together some characteristics that define the marketing, some of the drivers within a food system, of what you, what's going on. And I know I've left some things off, some intentional, some accidental, but I'll put this on here anyway. So, these are some big drivers within a food system that decide if they are gonna buy from them, and if they are gonna come buy what you're making, or if you're a restaurant or a grocery store, and how you're gonna prepare that food. That might come into the convenience. So somebody's going to be cooking on their own, or you're cooking it for. Cost, convenience, quality, the practices that you use, safety, narrative, and relationships. All right, these are all characteristics within a food system. They're things that you might want to use to help get your product from one place to another and help determine who is going to buy that product, who's going to spend their money, what are they spending it for? Are they spending their money because they're trying to get the most amount for the paying the least? Or because they don't want to do any preparation? Or because they like stuff that's really good and fresh and high quality? Or because they're concerned about the labor standards, the environmental practices, or they might be concerned about their own health? That might be a part of that. Or they're concerned about the food safety, the safety of that product. How is it being handled? Am I going to get E. coli or listeria after eating this? Do I know that safe practices are being employed? Narrative. If you're a farm, you know, that old oak tree that's sitting out there where it all began, you know, right around there, that, you know, that field that was right under there, that, you know, Grandpa, 120 years ago, he, you know, and then there's the old well, you know, we got our family story, we got our narrative. You know, that may be your narrative, or it may be the old cow, you know, or it may be a special kind of product that you're producing. But let's not forget relationships. Relationships are also really important. And let me tell you a bit about the narrative and the relationship. So let's say we're trying to create a food system here, and we have a lot of growers, a lot of young farmers that are coming out here. They're bursting on the scene, and that is great. We'd love to see that. And those farmers, you've got 10 farmers in this community of Jackson that are selling to 6 restaurants, right? Maybe 8 restaurants right here. And that's kind of the market. That's kind of the market for them right here. Because these farmers, they're getting started, they're young, they don't have a lot of money, they're moving that product through, they're trying to, you know, they're trying to make their ends meet. But what happens when you go from 10, 12 farmers to 20 farmers, or 30 farmers, but we haven't expanded our market yet? We still got 8 restaurants that are buying that. What happens within that?
Price competition.
You got price competition. So before, it was about narrative and relationships. You know, the narrative, this is a great narrative. This is a lovely local narrative. You know, now, you know, with so many people, cost becomes a factor. And people are going to say, all right, well, you know, I can buy this from 8 different people. Who's gonna have the cheapest? And then relationships becomes even more important. And you got people competing with each other now. Farmers who weren't before, they were all friends and everything was lovely and perfect before. Now they're at each other's throats and everybody's in a panic, you know. So now you're looking at really about that food system itself, that little ecosystem could be in danger, right? So I'm just trying to create some kind of context here to say that there are different kinds of food systems and there are different kinds of needs within that. Right now, one of the things that's not on here, and Leslie pointed to this earlier, is security. Security, food security. That is why we have our food system, a big part of that, as we do today with the Farm Bill from 1938 that set things in motion for the commodity crops that people grow, then the government buys when they go below market level, and the government then resells those commodity crops. And then your corn and your soy and your rice, they become the ingredients for everything in the marketplace that we have right now. And people are buying these really cheap. So they've got really cheap product. They're flooding the market with really cheap product because they've got the cheapest ingredients. You know, so it started with that food security, the desire that we needed to stockpile so our country does not suffer from hunger. You know, so that has led us to, well, now we've got a system where we've got this really cheap product. You know, where cost and convenience now become the expectations of the consumers at the expense of some of these other things. You know, but that's just the way it is. It doesn't mean that's the way it has to be. So in order to develop another system, a new system, we have to start looking at the quality of our food. We have to look at the practices that we are using. We have to build those into the narrative. And we have to use our relationships to help change the way people are currently moving and buying their product. Maybe focusing less on some of these factors and focusing more on this and this and this and this, without forgetting this. So that's all we said that as you start to build this kind of system, as you start to look at something that can be more sustainable and say, okay, we love your narrative, but at the end of the day, you're gonna have to come close on this cost. So how do you do that? Then it starts looking at that truck that's going from here to there, all right? Then it starts saying, okay, well, how can we get product on that truck to make it competitive to go back and forth so that we can compete with the stuff that's coming in from California or coming in from Mexico? There's a great presentation earlier, 50% of our product comes in from California, 50% of everything we eat, and 90% of our greens, lettuce. All right, so they've obviously got a pretty good system for delivery. How do we compete with that? You know, and to what degree should we focus on a way to compete with that, that is about growing in the community, it's about growing for each other, working with churches, working with community gardens, growing things that are going to be given away. You know, we're growing for good to feed hungry people. To what degree do we focus on the other side where it's like farming, this means jobs, labor, jobs, developing the economy, putting money in people's pockets so that they can then spend on other things? And are these two things exclusive? Are they mutually exclusive from each other, or can they exist side by side and support each other? Now, I think that they can, and I think that we're seeing here that there is a need for that. There's a need for both of those things. So up in Farms Food Hub, we're a new food hub in Jackson. Here we've got a building, we've got an 1,100 square foot cooler, and we're about to do some construction so that we'll have about 8,000 cold storage square feet and some different temperature rooms so we can handle a lot of different kinds of product, and we'll continue to expand beyond that. So we got a facility, all right? So that we can then help sell different narratives, use relationships, and keep the cost down, because we don't have all of these people trying to call you to get their product into your store. You know, it's just one group trying to coordinate for many people now. Not that you don't have your side deals and you're doing that, continue still, that's great. But you're looking at the end of the day, how can I manage my relationships, you know, so they're not too many? How can I keep my cost down? What's more convenient for me? And are we still supporting that? And this ends up becoming a volume issue, you know. So that's what we are focused on, moving product in volume in ways that we can do two things. One is create jobs, working with small, medium-sized farmers here in Mississippi who have struggled and will continue to struggle to get their product into places of mass purchase. So that's a challenge for them that we see, that by helping coordinate their growing, helping to solve irrigation issues for them, helping to solve labor issues for them, that helping to coordinate that whole practice, helping to coordinate the market so that they're not undercutting each other on deals, which happens inadvertently. You know, these are a lot of the things that we're doing as a hub to help move that product so that they can have more, you know, sustainable, less risky incomes coming in there. While at the same time, using some of the product that we're bringing through here to go back into communities of need. One of the things that we're very proud of, we just did a subscription program. It's kind of like a CSA. Everybody familiar with the CSA? So we did our own CSA. But we're not a farm. We did a CSA, we did a subscription service, where we brought product in for farms all around the state, which is really great. So some of these same farms, they have their own CSAs, but we're still moving product for them, and we're marketing who they are and what they do, and we're taking that, and about almost half of the subscriptions were sponsorships. We went out and got people to sponsor them. So we're delivering those products to the Mississippi Food Network, and they're going directly to communities of need. So families that didn't have product are now getting product delivered to them on a regular basis. So we're trying to help address the local food system at the same time. So how do you work on that and, you know, help people learn how to grow in their community gardens and make that a piece of that? In versus how do you create jobs on the other side and build farms where people are gonna be employed there and money's gonna come into those communities. So those are some of the conflicting things that we're doing. I think at this point, I'm gonna stop kind of doing this for a minute and ask Leslie to come back up here and let us answer some questions that y'all may have. And if not, then we can do more of this. But if so, you know, fire away. Ask us, what resonates with you from any of the things we're saying so far? We really are starting to talk about efficiencies. You're also starting to look at growing patterns in regions. You know, you can grow, believe it or not, I mean, there's like a 4-week window from the top of the state to the bottom of the state, 4 to 5 week window in terms of what you can grow and when. And you also want some geographical diversity. You don't want all of your squash coming from one field because that could be Tornado Alley, you know, or something else can happen. You need diversity of farms, things coming in from a lot of places, and you need to look at bringing in another product. We're really happy that we're doing Mississippi, we're doing Delta rice grits in our farm pack, and honey, and yogurt, and cheese as well. So it's not just produce, we're doing some other items. As you start trying to expand beyond that to take advantage of efficiencies, there are also costs that go into it. Because for some of these items, now you're looking at, instead of your 40 degree, your 32 to 40 degree area, now you're looking at sub 32 degree, which is an issue for transportation, but it's also an issue for storage, which means not just construction, but also utility costs. So there are factors within that, so you have to make sure that you have enough volume to move those things. But the advantage to that is, if you're already delivering to 50 grocery stores, you know, the more products that you can add in that, you know, the more you can leave at each store. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing. So that is a goal to get to. It's not where we are right now. This part of it is so complex to get right. But down the line, looking at goat meat, you know, eggs, looking at seafood, moving other items like that, that if we're doing it directly or not, doesn't matter. It's about a coordinated effort. So again, taking different kinds of systems that could be isolated and looking at their linkages between them so that there's coordination on that, which ultimately reduces the cost.
Two questions. We may have already gone over this, but is the Food Hub a nonprofit or is it an LLC?
So we are an LLC, and we spent a long time pondering that decision. What are we going to do? Are we a for-profit or are we a non-profit? We are a for-profit with a social mission, and fortunately that we've got partners who are dedicated to that, and they understand what that means. But you know, we're also people who are taking on a lot of personal debt in order to make this happen. Which is different from what you do within a nonprofit. So we have stake in that. Now, that makes a difference to our farmers. It really does. We believe that we want the supply chain to be sustainable economically. And so we're committed to that. But when our farmers know that we have skin in the game just like they do, they are protective of us. I mean, really, it's amazing. David, y'all okay? Y'all doing okay? We're like, yeah, we're doing fine. We're doing fine, Mr. Gregory. You know, so we're working with them. We have to protect them. They have to protect us. So it creates actually a really strong bond that we didn't necessarily expect. We just came in from the idea of we wanted to see an economically sustainable supply chain. But within that, what we realized and really known from the beginning is that there are pieces of that outside of the supply chain that are really about the value chain that need nonprofit activity. This is about developing farmers, it's about doing training. There's so many things that if we were just strictly a nonprofit a for-profit that did not have grant access right now, we could not do. So we are very much reliant on grants in this phase to do the thing, to provide the services to the farmers that we need. We're helping bring irrigation practices to about 30 farms. Right now. This is a really significant breakthrough, something that we've been working on with NRCS to help small, medium-sized farmers be able to apply for these packages of irrigation. We've been working on it for a couple of years, and now that's a big thing. But without assistance, we would not be able to do that. So we see that there's a lot of value that must exist on that side and on the community food side. You know,
So I started a food hub in southeastern North Carolina, and it's still in existence. It's doing really well. It runs, in our good years, it's around $300,000 to $400,000 a year. So it's a very small hub, has about 25 farmers that bring product in every Wednesday, and it goes out Thursday to the institutions in a 50-mile radius. So it's very tiny, and Dave's thinking big, right? And we kept ours very small intentionally. It is a nonprofit, and it still has that trust and those things that you described that you know you felt was only because you had skin in the game, but through the reciprocity and the trust that was created, these embedded relationships, it's that same spirit of what he described with the growers, are you know, that connection. And so ours is just a smaller scale than what they envision, but it's a very it does have grant support still, but I think if we got another 100,000 a year, we could probably, bring on a whole other position. We've got three people who have staffed through that to make it run. So I don't have a problem with having grant funding to do this work. I think that, you know, we looked at the farm bill that gives lots of support and buttressing of work, of funding streams to help commodity production. I'm not so sure we shouldn't have some policy that looks at that as well for these small hubs. And so we have a lot of the sort of the community piece that goes with that. We work in food deserts. We have a fresh market that's connecting limited resource growers to limited resource consumers. And so these things, very similar to what Up and Farm wants to do and is doing. So they're different models, as David said. They're many different models.
And they can exist beside each other.
Absolutely.
And one is not necessarily better than the other. We just made the decision at the outset, but the key thing is that there's a set of activities that has to happen. And some of those activities have a cost. And in some communities, those activities have more of a cost than in other places. If you put up a food hub in the Northeast or Northwest, you might have more initial capitalization cost, but there's already so many other pieces of infrastructure in place that you can plug into. You don't have to do as much operationally necessarily. There are other places you can partner with, and those things are already in existence. Here, it's more complex because our food system infrastructure has atrophied to an extraordinary degree. So when we start talking about this, we're trying to do this, and suddenly we find we're doing this, and this, and this, and we really have to build everything up from scratch. Because if you're missing one chain in the supply chain, then the whole thing is broken, yeah. You know.
And that's why I think this, you need a statewide infrastructure, as well as these pieces of food hub. I mean, I think just in observing this for 10 years and learning from it, you've got to have many things happening together simultaneously. Yeah.
Is maybe the weakest links are some of the biggest challenges?
There is a limit to the day to this. Workshop.
Yes.
It does end, you know.
Right at the top.
So really the limit and the opportunity are really it's scale. Now, so scale and the initial coordination that it takes to reach the break-even point for the system. If you step back and you say it's not just us, but you look at any system, you're going to have common activities, assets, subject matter experts in place to make something work. And depending on the community, that might be a $10 million investment, it might be a $20 million investment. In order to have the $10 million throughput to make it self-sustaining. You know? So that's what we're trying to get, is that the initial activities and subject matter experts, and now dealing with food safety, it's another thing, and that's another expense that's going to have to be borne by the system in different ways. And we're discussing what role extension can play in that, and what role nonprofit, and what role for-profit. because that it's just another expense, so that it's not all being borne by the farmer. But at the end of the day, it's kind of a simultaneous leap of faith from a number of groups at the same time. Farmers willing to say, yes, I'm going to bite the bullet, and I know I'm going to make less money by growing in this market, but it's going to give me the chance to expand and focus more on farming and less on having to be a marketing and social media expert who is every farmer's market within 90 miles. You know, and being able to do part of that with grocery stores who are willing to say, if you can tell me, you know, 3-4 weeks in advance the product that you're going to have coming in, then I'm willing to buy it from you. And we'll forego our warehouse. We won't buy from that. We're committed to buy, as long as you can keep it within this range, this price range, we'll buy from you instead. You know? So do we have a consistency of product coming in to be able to do that, and enough scale to make sense to move it in the trucks? So it's getting to that leap of faith level that's the real challenge. You know, it takes time to do it. It takes some subsidy and investment to have everybody get there at once. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Well, how do you know if your community is ready for the establishment
of a
new
hub,
or would even be a good place to have
food help? Well, I mean, a lot of things that have to be in place. I mean, we just did it. So I can tell you, where you are in Lafayette County, you're probably poised for that, right? So but for me, it's public-private partnerships that are really critical. And so who is willing to step to the table on this effort? And so the food hub we created in southeastern North Carolina was in partnership with the town. You know, and so we had building space, and we had many pieces coming into it, both public and private money and infrastructure. So that was really critical. But I think you have to build the demand, you have to get the institutions in place to purchase. That procurement piece is so difficult. You have to have demand through a consumer base that's ready for it and committed to it, and so you have to build that sometimes too. So your place is ready. I don't know what your public and private pieces are, but I can see it when I'm there.
Well,
that you have it.
I kind of get the sense that it's putting it all together.
It is, and that does not happen easy, and it's a commitment. And but what is lovely about Lafayette County is you've got planners, you've got elected officials who are there, ready. Maybe there's some local policy that could be developed around this to help make that happen. You've got a school system purchasing locally and cooking meal, local, so you're educating kids on this, you've got food court there. You've got a lot of pieces. But yeah, it wouldn't happen overnight, and it does take organizing. To me, it's some grassroots organizing that has to be done.
Are y'all looking at establishing as a for-profit or a non-profit?
Well, I don't know. But I'm the manager of a farmer's market that is a non-profit.
Okay. So, there are different approaches within that, and figuring out the word food hub can mean a lot of different things. You know, it's not, this is a food hub. I mean, this can be a food hub, or this part of it can be a food hub, or this, or the whole thing. It's very hard to do all that. I know when we were developing ours, I went out to a group of subject matter experts and brought them in. Established restaurateurs and people who knew what gap training was. You know, people who understood the food system. I brought them into my group so that they could be stakeholders within it and rely on a lot of their relationships. And so we could build upon that. That was important. But it also depends on what you want to do. Yeah, if you want to plug into existing distributors, you can focus more on developing the farmers. I can tell you that if you don't focus on developing the farmers as part of what you do, you're not going to have a food hub. You know, you're a broker for people who are already doing things, and they may come and go, and they may not ever have any real loyalty to you, you know, or you to them. But if you're really trying to be a food hub, that is the key part of the working with the farmers and building that capacity with them. You can find other people to help distribute that, because you might want to rely on existing, you know, trucking systems, as we're doing. We're not trying to create a whole trucking infrastructure, you know. But there is a lot of opportunity to help figure out and define what you may already be a food hub, you know, without even really calling yourself that in some of the activities you're doing. Yes, ma'am.
Hey, so my name is Elizabeth. I'm from the University of Georgia, and Real Food Challenge. I just wanted to know, has anybody here heard of Real Food Challenge before? Today? Okay. Cool. Yeah, so basically, that you're talking about like institutional procurement. So we're trying to build a student movement to get university college campuses to commit to sourcing heritable sustainable family food. And I guess I just want to put that plug in. You know, this is one component of the many simultaneous things that have happened, you know, but there are any active chapters for Real Food right now, and if you're connected to like the city state or something, you know, students or people who want to get involved, talk to me, because I'd love to get that conversation started. And using students' power to influence institutions to get that ball rolling as challenging as it may be.
And that's our biggest purchaser at our food hub in North Carolina, through the University of North Carolina, Wilmington, through the Airmark food service provider, the director. And he's leading these workshops across the nation, so he's a real innovator. And
what's
yeah, we've come.
What's his name?
Matt Rogers.
Matt Rogers.
Yeah, and I'm happy to connect you. But cool. It's huge in our sales, right? And so he tells that story. He has farmers that come in, they do tastings, and then, you know, they purchase. So it's really helpful.
Cool.
Great. Thank you. How are we on time? So we've been told that the hook is coming and pulling us off. I think Leslie and I will remain. There's a lovely dance floor here if any of you want to pop in. But we're here if y'all have further questions.
Thank you.